Okay, we are live on Google Plus Hangouts on air. Joel Berg, thank you so much for joining us today. I really appreciate you guys, you and your team and everyone who's watching right now, sticking with us through our technical difficulties.
My pleasure. For people who hung on, thank you.
So just a little quick introduction to what we're doing here today. This is our inaugural Hunger Action Month Google Plus Hangout. And so what we're doing during Hunger Action Month is taking an opportunity to raise awareness of hunger by having some conversations on Google Plus to talk about different issues that are related to the issue of hunger. Brief introduction again, I'm Sarah Peralta with the Capillary Food Bank, and Joel Berg, who's with the New York City Coalition Against Hunger. And so the Capillary Food Bank is a the Capillary Food Bank of Texas specifically is a food bank here in Central Texas. We're based, headquartered in Austin. We serve 21 counties across Central Texas. Our land, I guess, or a square mileage of area that we cover is equivalent to twice the size of the state of Massachusetts. So, two times Massachusetts. It's a lot of area to cover. We serve 48,000 people a week, which is a lot of folks. And of those 48,000 people, 20,000 are children. So we are very, very familiar with the issue of food insecurity in our community. And so that's why it's a priority for us to talk about hunger issues here during Hunger Action Month with Joel Berg, who will introduce himself shortly. I just want to encourage folks that if you have a question during our conversation, you can tweet on our hashtag on Twitter. It's a hashtag CAFBTX. That's Capillary Food Bank Texas, but the letters. CAFBTX on Twitter, and we'll be taking your questions and answering them later on during the broadcast. So, Joel, let's go ahead and cut to you. Can you tell us a little bit about your background? You have a pretty long career in policy issues, and how you got involved with the issue of hunger in general.
Well, thanks so much for having me, and thanks for folks who tuned in. I've been doing public policy work, political work, and social justice work since I was 14 in some way, shape, or form. I started as a college activist, worked on a number of political campaigns and causes, worked for a think tank in Washington, D.C. in the late 80s, early 90s called the Progressive Policy Institute, which was trying to create new ideas to fight pressing social problems and other problems in America. And one of the ideas they worked on was this whole idea of AmeriCorps, what became a domestic Peace Corps that was actually implemented by President Clinton and Congress and actually encouraged by President Bush as well. I worked on President Clinton's campaign. I was actually in not too far from Texas in Kansas at the end of that campaign, and I ended up on his transition team helping flesh out the details of national service. Then I ended up at the USDA, the U.S. Department of Agriculture, served there for all 8 years in the Clinton administration, worked on this AmeriCorps National Service Program, and when we did that, we did rural economic development projects, including a lot of projects in southern Texas, in the Colonias area, in the Rio Grande Valley area, so I learned a lot about Texas hunger and poverty. Then we also had environmental projects working on national forests, but we also had anti-hunger projects, and that's how I transitioned into hunger work. So my last few years at USDA was focused entirely on anti-hunger work. I helped then Secretary of Agriculture Glickman start a thing called the Community Food Security Initiative, which was designed to help the federal government work more closely with nonprofit groups and integrate them with federal programs to help reduce hunger in America. And a little over 12 years ago, I came back home to New York to head the New York City Coalition Against Hunger, which is a direct service group, a technical assistance group, but also a capacity building group and advocacy group. Our motto is helping move society beyond the soup kitchen to a time when everyone has a living wage jobs and has an adequate safety net so they can support their own families. And we are now a quasi-national organization. We actually have Vista AmeriCorps projects throughout the country, including a number across the state of Texas, helping people access government nutrition assistance benefits, teaching nutrition education, and helping people access job training programs.
And we actually have two of those AmeriCorps here on staff here at the food bank. So thank you for taking the lead on that. Melanie and Todd are our wonderful Vistas who are helping us bring relief and support to folks who are food insecure here in Texas.
And I thank federal taxpayers for helping support this vital program. It builds community, promotes opportunity, gets concrete things done in the country and in communities across the country, and really helps middle class and low income, Americans pay their way through college the best way possible, serving their communities. It's sort of a GI Bill without the GI. Now, in this conversation, I may get some policy questions and I may answer them, but I just want to be clear. Our Vista AmeriCorps program is entirely detached from any policy or advocacy work we do. That's a different hat we wear, and when I'm talking about policy today, that's very different than our federally funded programs. For any lawyers recording this, that's my disclaimer.
Fair enough. Joel, let's go ahead and get started with the questions. So can you give us a brief history on the, the hunger relief in the United States, at least in more recent times. Tell us a little bit about what that has looked like historically.
I'll start with the bad news, and then I'll give a little better news. The bad news is just the other day, the federal government released its data on hunger and the wonkish term food insecurity in America. And the federal government indicated that 49 million Americans, including 16 million American children, live in households that can't afford enough food. Now, those numbers don't represent Somalia-like starvation or North Korea-style mass malnutrition. What they refer to is hunger in the American context of people choosing between food and rent, people rationing food, people skipping meals, parents going without meals because they're feeding their children, children going without meals because there's no meals over the summer or no meals over the weekend or the schools aren't providing school breakfast, and the children doing far less well in school and developing less well. And unfortunately, as you guys know, Texas has one of the worst problems in the entire nation. In the last three-year period, 18.4% of people in the state of Texas lived in households that couldn't afford enough food. Now, many people like me weren't great at math, so don't understand what 18.4% means. That means one in five. That means if you're in a classroom, if you're in a low-income workplace, if you're in a street corner, look to your right, look to your left. You won't know what a hungry person looks like because they defy all stereotypes. They're all races. They're all ages. They're all genders. They're all regions of the states. They're urban, rural, and suburban. But you look to your right, look to your left, wherever you are, and one out of five statistically would be food insecure. That's the bad news. The good news is that even though we had a far worse problem in America in the Great Depression, because we developed safety net programs, we almost entirely ended hunger in America in the 1970s because we had higher wages and we had a more robust nutrition assistance safety net. And honestly, we've gone backwards in the last few decades with broken economic policies, broken social policies that have allowed hunger to fester. We are the only Western industrialized nation on the planet with this massive level of hunger. And I'm not even talking about a raw number because we're just a bigger, more populous country. I'm talking about per capita. We have far more hunger than most of Western Europe, far more hunger than Canada, and so it is something really uniquely broken about our economic and social policies, unfortunately.
So there's a lot of things going on there, obviously. A lot of changes that have happened, and we may have lost some ground there in the fight to end hunger here in the United States. Can you go ahead and tell me that there's obviously different ways that hunger relief is delivered in the community? What is the difference between public programs that work on hunger relief and private programs?
Private programs, such as those sponsored by the Capillary Food Bank of Texas, are absolutely critical. They're absolutely vital. People would be really further falling through the cracks and starving without them. And so I'd urge everyone listening or viewing this to send a check to the Capillary Food Bank of Texas. Don't bring a can. Checks are far more effective, and engage in their public policy efforts. That being said, we have to be straight with people. Every food bank, every food rescue group, every soup kitchen, every food pantry, every food program at a homeless shelter in America provides less than 1/20 of the Federal Nutrition Assistance Safety Net. Less than 1/20 of SNAP, the recent name for food stamps, the WIC program, school breakfast, school lunch, summer meals, the WIC program. What does that mean? Government provides 20 times what every charity provides. And so forget ideology, forget party or partisanship, just look at the facts. And the facts show that by marginally increasing wages, you know, a minimum wage, or by a marginally increasing the size and scope and impact of the Federal Nutrition Assistance Safety Net, you could dramatically reduce, and in a few short years actually end hunger in America. In contrast, you could dramatically increase, you could double, quadruple, tenfold the role of charities in America, and they would barely dent the problem. I do put this in a Texas context, that when there was that horrible tragedy in West Texas, there was an understanding that there was a role for the federal government to play, because it's on our nation's interest. It's on our nation's interest to help our neighbors. And people understood that the scope of the problem was too great for West Texas to handle on their own, or even the whole state of Texas to handle on their own, that you needed a national government response. Same with the horrible tornadoes in Oklahoma. And I note that people across the political spectrum, including people who believe, you know, say they're for very limited, you know, government, who are very conservative, understood that in that Texas tragedy, in that Oklahoma tragedy, we needed neighbors pitching in. We needed the state and local governments doing their role. We needed charities to do their role. But that was no substitute for a robust leadership from the federal government. And that's my point about hunger as well. It is a mass problem that crosses community lines, crosses state lines, cannot possibly be fixed by charities alone. So I urge people, we're a big enough country to walk and chew gum at the same time. And individuals ought to be able to support their local, you know, organizations and charities and food banks at the same time, understand that that's not a long-term answer to the problem. We also have to engage in public policy advocacy. And just one more example of the stakes. Every soup kitchen, food pantry, food bank, you know, food rescue group in America provides, in aggregate, in total, about $5 billion worth of food. That's great, and that's important. But the Senate Farm Bill that passed the Democratic-controlled Senate would cut $5 billion out of the SNAP Nutrition Assistance Program. So the Senate Farm Bill would, if that was enacted, that would be as if every charity in America didn't exist for a year. Now, some of your viewers may know that the House has been talking about a farm bill that would cut $40 billion out of the program, which is, obviously 8 times the Senate cuts. And I think the Senate cuts are unbelievable as it is. And so if those House budget cuts went through as proposed, that would be the equivalent of every charity in America, the more than 40,000 community soup kitchens and food pantries and food banks, not existing for 8 years. And to add to that, there was a budget proposal that passed the House of Representatives, the so-called Ryan, you know, budget, that would have cut over $100 billion from these programs. So it would have been as if these programs didn't exist for more than a decade. So those are the stakes. We need both. It's a false choice to say we must do one or the other.
So those are some really, really harsh realities that we're dealing with, you know, that the fact that we are going to have to face cuts coming up soon. Before I ask the next question, I'm going to remind everyone that
if we don't fight back to defeat them, we're going to have to face cuts. I never accept that. And when some people say, well, boy, you're a little hard line, you won't accept a penny of cuts in these programs. Low-income people have been cut and cut and cut. Their wages have been cut. Their programs are cut. They're becoming hungrier. They're becoming, you know, homelessness is still a huge problem around the country. Poverty is still a huge problem despite the recession. So I think people have to understand the low-income people have given and given and given way more than their, you know, fair share. We cannot possibly, it's not the moral thing to do, it's not the practical thing to do to say we can balance the budget on the backs of low-income Americans.
I just want to remind everybody real quick that if you would like to ask a question, you can tweet on our hashtag pound or hashtag CAFBTX, so that's Capillary Food Bank of Texas, CAFBTX on Twitter, and we'll be able to get to your questions later on there, during this broadcast. Joel, so this is obviously a tough situation for those of us that are in the business of hunger relief. What are some of the things that are missing, I guess, in the conversation about hunger? Missing in the delivery, missing in how people understand hunger. What's the missing link there?
A whole lot of things are missing because the media has basically stopped covering it in any serious way. As I said, just 2 days ago, the federal government released data saying that 49 million Americans, you know, were hungry or food insecure. What's the population of Texas these days? You know, it's
about 26 million more or less.
Yeah, so consider this: double the population, the number of people hungry and food insecure in America equals basically double the population of the entire state of Texas. So for the elites who say this is a hidden problem, I say it's a hidden problem to you because you're not looking. So number one, people don't understand the extent of the problem. Two, they have these horrible, horrible stereotypes that it's someone else. It's a different kind of people. Honestly, to be blunt about it, as I'm a blunt fellow, a lot of white people falsely believe it's mostly about non-white people. When the plurality of people hungry, poor, receiving food stamps, the few people still getting cash assistance in America always have been and continue to be Caucasian. They are sometimes the stereotype that it's this inner city problem. Surely inner city, Austin inner city, you know, Dallas inner city, Houston have a serious problem, but this is a serious problem in small rural communities throughout Texas. It's a problem in suburbs. Suburbs have had the fastest growing rate of hunger anywhere in the United States. There's a stereotype that people somehow don't want to work. The vast majority of hungry people are either working families, children, senior citizens, or veterans. The very people our society say we owe the most to, not who are somehow dependent on it. Ironically, for sort of the politicalization of this issue, the states that tend to have elected officials that are most antagonistic to these programs tend to be the states that have the highest percentage of their population requiring these programs. There was a fascinating story in the media the other day of a gentleman from the South. He appeared from the photo to be Caucasian, and he sheepishly admitted that he received food stamps and explained how he really needed and was down on his luck. But then he said, oh, well, we ought to have much tougher standards for everyone else because everyone else is fraudulent. And that, unfortunately, is the reality of our politics today. People seem to think that the only virtuous recipients of any government program are themselves and their families. So all this is misunderstood about government. There's a lot of myths, and some of these are promoted because of a political agenda, about the Federal Nutrition Safety Net programs. The SNAP program, the Federal Nutrition Assistance Program, formerly known as food stamps, is one of the most effective programs ever in American history, whether it's a nonprofit program, a private sector program, a government program. First of all, I remind my conservative friends, the food stamps program is a voucher program. A lot of conservatives support vouchers when it comes to schools. We hope they would support vouchers when it comes to food. In countries that have policies that are far more liberal than the United States, let's say India or Mexico, low-income people are sent with their government food program to a government food warehouse. That's not the case with the SNAP program. You are sent to your local HEB, am I pronouncing it? You know, right there in Texas? Your supermarket chain there? They are sent to your Kroger. They are sent to your Walmart. They are sent to your Piggly Wiggly. And so therefore we are supporting the private sector in this. Your face isn't moving. Is this still working? I will keep talking unless I am told otherwise. In any case, there's also the stereotypes that somehow there is a lot of fraud in the SNAP program, when in fact, there's only 1.3% fraud. The fraud rate in the United States House of Representatives has been about 2%. And so there's actually twice as much fraud in the House of Representatives as there is in the SNAP program. And so I would, respectfully suggest. Problem. The first one was our fault, the second one was not. Yeah. We back?
Yes, I'm so sorry about that technical glitch.
Where were we cut off? I was on a long...
You were on a roll.
I was on a roll. Where did I stop?
First, let me just apologize, everybody. I'm sorry. That, unfortunately, is one of the realities of working for nonprofits. Sometimes things don't always go 100%, and again, I thank you for sticking with us as we do this.
Although, if any of you out there happen to have some resources and want to make a significant donation to the Capillary Food Bank of Texas or the New York City Hunger Coalition Against Hunger to improve our Wi-Fi capacities, I don't want to go out on a limb and speak on behalf of the food bank, but I think giving you a large contribution, probably no one there will get mad at. Boy, that would really help.
Well, Joel, we really appreciate all your words today, so thank you so much. We were just starting to talk about, I think I gave a plug for our hashtag again. We're still taking questions. We have no problem with that. Hashtag CAFETX. We have been talking about different types of hunger relief, and then we got cut off.
You asked me what people didn't know, and mm-hmm. I was saying that they don't know that the SNAP program is really effective. It's a market-driven program that actually helps businesses greatly. Mark Zandes, who is an economist for Moody's Corporation, who was an advisor to John McCain's presidential campaign, has said that SNAP benefits are one of the best economic stimuluses this economy has. Every dollar spent on SNAP creates $1.73 of economic activity. SNAP is a voucher program. It doesn't go to a government agency when it's spent. It actually goes to a Walmart. It goes to a HEB. Is that how the supermarket chain in Texas is pronounced? It goes to HEB. It goes to a Piggly Wiggly. Some of these other parts of the country, that's my favorite supermarket chain name. It goes to a Pathmark, a Kroger's, all these, a Vons. It goes to private sectors, places, Costco's, and creates jobs at every step of the process while feeding people. It has an extraordinarily low fraud rate. There's only about 1.3% fraud in the SNAP program, far less than in most other government or private sector programs. I point out to conservative, some people in the House of Representatives who criticize the program, that the fraud rate of the members of the House of Representatives who've pled guilty to crimes or found guilty of crimes is 2%. And so before you go get too mad about SNAP, you ought to look a little closer to home and really go after fraud that matters. And so I hope people just understand that the average length of time on SNAP for new people before the recession was 6 months. After the recessions, it's about 8 to 10 months. It is not a way of life for a lifetime. It helps people when they are down on their luck, temporarily. And most of us have periods in our life where we're down on our luck and need a little help. And so I think people say, well, we want neighbors to help neighbors. And you should understand that some of these government nutrition assistance programs are actually a very efficient way of neighbors helping neighbors, because neighbors pay taxes into the system, and then they support benefits with very detailed strategies to make sure the benefits are only going to those who need it most.
So obviously government is a huge part of how hunger relief is delivered. You are working for a private nonprofit. Can you tell me a little bit about some of the innovations you've seen in the nonprofit sector or new programs that the government has been working on, things that are most effective in delivering aid to people who are food insecure?
Well, great question. I think one of the most important things that nonprofits can do is work in public-private partnerships with the federal government to increase participation in their programs and do the community kind of outreach and access building that community groups may be better at government than. Texas has one of the lowest rates of SNAP participation in the country, also has a real challenge in some areas with school breakfast participation and participation patient in summer meals program, particularly because it's just so darn hot where you guys are in the summer. It's hard to get people out in the summer to get summer meals, and the kids normally would be getting school lunch. And so there are very effective partnerships that my organization has, that we do with food banks in Texas, that we do with the Texas Hunger Initiative based at Baylor, to really do the outreach on these programs, to let people know they're eligible for these programs, to let working families know, children, parents know that their children are eligible, seniors know that they're eligible, veterans know that they're eligible if they have the income eligibility for these programs. So that's one thing we've done that's very effective. We also have a thing called food action boards, where we're organizing the people who get food from soup kitchens into food pantries to speak out on their own behalf. Some people say giving them a voice. I think that's a little condescending. They already have a voice. We just want to make sure their voice is heard in Washington and our state capital here in New York or places like Austin to really say, hey, there are 49 million of us around the country. No problem in all of American history has been solved without the significant involvement of the people most impacted by the problem. And that's why we feel so strongly that hungry people shouldn't just be passive recipients of food at these charities, but should have a say in the governance of those agencies, should be involved in volunteering at those agencies, and should really be engaged in public policy. A typical congressperson, when they want to hear about farm policy, they're going to ask a farmer. If they want to learn about law enforcement, they're going to ask a police officer or a union. You're representing police officers. If they want to learn about what's good for business, most likely they will go to businesses or businesses organizations. It is shocking to me how little our public officials, when they want to learn about hunger and poverty, if they want to learn about hunger and poverty, actually ask people in hunger and poverty. So that food action board process is something that we find really important. We also have an initiative that's working nationwide, and let me plug this. It's called Ending Hunger Through Citizen Service, and you can go to our website at www.hungervolunteer.org. That's www.hungervolunteer.org, and this effort is generously funded by the ConAgra Foods Foundation, and the idea is to improve the way people volunteer to fight hunger. let me be, you know, blunt as I've been. The two most common ways that people volunteer to fight hunger are actually the two least effective. One is doing a canned food drive, and two is showing up on Thanksgiving or Christmas to volunteer with a group of lots of friends, having 50 people show up at an agency that needs 5 people. You know, food drives are great. If that's all you can do, do them and donate the food to your local food bank. But I guarantee the Austin food bank there, Capillary Food Bank, could better use cash because they buy wholesale. They get donated food, so your money would be supporting them actually moving the food, not just buying the food. So I'm just making up these numbers. But if you buy a can for a buck versus give the food bank a buck when they can get 3 cans for that, it makes a lot more sense to raise the money. So we're telling people, you know, think twice about, you know, food banks. Think instead of giving money or raising money. And we give a lot of concrete examples of how just regular people, not even rich people, can do grassroots community fundraisers. And another thing to think about a food drive is if your grandmother or grandfather couldn't afford enough prescription drugs, would you ask everyone in the neighborhood to go into their medicine cabinet and donate the prescription drugs they think your grandmother or grandfather needed? You wouldn't even think of that. You would say, gee, what does their doctor recommend? What do they want? And how can we get the monetary resources to get those prescription drugs? And that's what we need to do with food. We ask people, you know, it's great showing up on Christmas and Thanksgiving, but volunteer in February, volunteer in August. That's when the need is really there. And even better, showing up in a large group to serve soup or cut up the carrots or stock the cans, because honestly, most organizations have more than enough volunteers needed to do that, is use your professional skills. If you know how to create a website, help a small church pantry in your neighborhood do a website. If you know how to do accounting, help them with their spreadsheet. If you know how to write and edit, help them with their grants. Honestly, a half hour mentoring a small, you know, mom and pop run, you know, community feeding agency will do a lot more to reduce hunger. You know, if you help them revamp their accounting system so they can get more grants, that will do a heck of a lot more to reduce hunger than 6 months of volunteering to just, you know, pack cans. We urge volunteers to help people access government benefits, including SNAP benefits. We have a big effort to get corporations and other people to use volunteers to help promote the summer meals program, because so many kids who have school lunch don't get summer meals. We encourage people to serve on the boards of nonprofit groups. That's another great way to use your skills. And we encourage people to volunteer to engage in public policy advocacy. Honestly, 5 minutes contacting your elected officials can do more than 5 years of serving soup to really, you know, address this problem. Elected officials, believe it or not, do respond to calls. They do respond to emails. If not, they're out on their rears, if I may say. And so all this we encourage. We have a handbook we can send people. If you're not into, you know, email, you can contact. If you're not into online stuff, you can call us at 212-825-0028. And we will send you one of these guides. But I assume if you're on this broadcast here, you have web access, quite obviously. So go to www.hungervolunteer.org, and you can see how you can do this. Also, you can go to the website of the New York City Coalition Against Hunger at www.nyccah.org and find out about our other programs. One other innovative program we have, it's a community-supported agriculture program that buys food directly from regional farmers and delivers it to low-income neighborhoods and subsidizes it heavily. And not only do we feed people healthier food through this project, but we actually disprove the myth that low-income people don't want healthier food, they're too lazy, there's something culturally wrong with them, they just don't know about it, they're too ignorant. We've proven if you build it, they will come. If you make healthier food convenient and available, low-income people will flock to get it. And that's what we think public policy has to do, and that's what we're doing at the New York City Coalition Against Hunger.
So a lot of things that people can do to get involved and make a real difference in the community. Thank you for all that information. I want to also encourage everyone, we're still taking questions off of Twitter, hashtag CAFBTX, that stands for Capillary Food Bank of Texas, hashtag CAFBTX, and I'm going to go ahead and start with some of our questions with our remaining amount of time, if that's okay with you, Joel.
Absolutely.
Awesome. Well, we have Joanna Linden has asked us, three things you can do. The three things you do you think about need to think about to end hunger. So thinking about things, strategies to end hunger, what are some things that folks need to think about?
To be really clear about it, I'd say call your two United States senators. That's number one. Call your member of the House of Representatives and say we should be investing in ending hunger in America, not cutting these programs. Ending hunger in America will save our economy $167 billion a year because hungry children don't learn as well. Hungry senior citizens stay less independent and have higher health care costs. Hungry workers are less productive or less able to find and keep employment. I've calculated we could end hunger entirely in America for about $30 billion of spending a year. That sounds like a lot, but that's a heck of a lot less than the $167 billion a year we spent. If you know, Texans are known for your just straight talk and common sense. If you owned a house and you had a hole in the roof and you knew that because of that hole in your roof, you are losing $167 a year to extra pay you had to pay on air conditioning. In the North, they say air conditioning and heating, and you guys all say air conditioning. And you could fix it for $30. If you could fix a problem for $30 that cost you $167, of course you'd fix it if you had that money in your pocket. And respectfully, America has that money in its pocket. And so first and foremost is contact your U.S. senators. Senator Cornyn, Senator Cruz, find your members of the House of Representatives. I know at least one member, Congressman Doggett, represents at least some of your service area there. Contact him. I don't know all the other members of Congress from the area. And three, go to www.hungervolunteer.org to find very concrete, specific ways that you can volunteer to make the biggest impact. One-on-one charity is great, but we used to fight fires with bucket brigades, one bucket at a time. It defined the spirit of compassion and giving and volunteerism that made America great. Unfortunately, city after city still burnt to a crisp. And unfortunately, food drives are the bucket brigades of our time. They make us feel good. They give us something to do, but they are not really solving the problem. So, my hope for people is that you will not only act with your hearts, as millions of Americans already have had to volunteer and donate, but also act with your heads. Do the things that make you feel good, but they make you feel good because they're having the biggest impact. And knowing that you can actually end hunger in America will make you feel a lot better than knowing you're just helping someone go to a food pantry or soup kitchen for another year.
Some great thoughts on how to make a real difference. Thank you for that. I have a question from John Turner. So he wants to know what you think about the recent cuts, the recent efforts for the GOP to tie SNAP benefits to working and potentially drug testing. So,
first, let me be clear that the New York City Coalition Against Hunger is a studiously nonpartisan organization, as I know the Capital Area Food Bank of Texas is. So I'm not responding based on which party has proposed this. I'm responding based on the substance of the policies. And I will say that I did work for President Clinton. He did implement welfare reform, and he did, support, work requirements for cash assistance. And he did support a dramatic ramp down of cash assistance, what we know of as welfare. And that's controversial. Even many of my peers in the anti-hunger movement, oppose that, bitterly. Cash assistance, true welfare, has been dramatically reduced in America. Less than 10% of the people in America who are poor, get cash assistance, and only about 8% of people in America who get SNAP benefits, food stamps, receive cash assistance. The truth of the matter is SNAP helps people stay off of cash welfare because it rewards work. SNAP isn't welfare. It is work support. It helps ensures that if you're working hard and playing by the rules, you actually earn a little more and get a little more help to feed your family. The truth of the matter is the vast majority of people in the SNAP program already are working people, are senior citizens, are people with disabilities, are children. And so people are already working, or people, I hope, you know, your viewers would understand that, you know, we moved beyond child labor 100 years ago and we shouldn't go back to that. There are already work requirements in the SNAP program for able-bodied adults without dependents. That's a wonkish term, but for people 18 through 50, without any children, there are already work requirements in the program. So let me repeat. Most people in the program, the vast majority of people in the program, are either already working, are children, are senior citizens, are people with disabilities, and those who aren't in those categories already have work requirements. So all this talk about adding work requirements for food stamps and additional work requirements for food stamps, honestly, is a whole lot of demagoguing, a whole lot of political, you know, nonsense, and would actually cost taxpayers far more money than it would ever save, because what happens when you have some of these things is you have these fake make-work things. You send people to office, spending hours in a class about how to get a job, taking time away from actually working in a job, spending hours in this ridiculous resume class on how to create a resume. Many low-income jobs don't need a resume. And then drug requirements. Let's be clear. The states that have passed drug testing have found that people on public assistance per capita are using fewer drugs less frequently than the population as a whole. It is more demagoguing. It is more punishing people because they happen to be low income. You would never, never, never hear someone suggest work requirements or drug testing for the programs that benefit wealthy Americans. You never hear them suggest that when a wealthy person gets a tax break for the vacation home, they should have extra work requirements or they should have drug testing. You'd never hear that when a large agribusiness gets a huge check, arguably a socialist check from the government, to pay them for their private sector activity, farm subsidies, agribusiness subsidies, you'd never, never, never hear that there should be a drug testing for those programs or extra work requirements for those programs. Texas legislature, I understand, meets once every 2 years. One could argue, some cynical people say maybe there should be more work requirements or drug testings for state legislatures, but you never hear people suggesting that. And so honestly, you know, this isn't about party, but the people proposing that have a lot of answering to do. One congressman from Tennessee, who is one of the most fierce opponents of SNAP benefits and who's misquoted the Bible to say somehow it violates the Bible, who said we can't keep printing money forever. He personally, his family, has received over $1 million in socialist government agriculture subsidies over the last decade. And so before we start pointing fingers, at low-income people and creating these vast bureaucracies, and that's the last thing. It is ironic to me that some people who claim they want government off their back when it comes to other people, when it comes to poor people, they want government on their back, their front, their top, and their bottom. And they're really calling for massive, intrusive, big government micromanaging the lives of fellow citizens. I don't think that's smart public policy. That's a colossal waste of money. And I'd argue that's not even truly conservative. So I gave a long answer because this is a complicated, complex issue. But I did think your viewers deserved a long answer on that. I believe that work should be the centerpiece of all social policy. And guess what? The vast majority of low-income people, the vast majority of people receiving SNAP benefits would far, far, far prefer to have a job that pays a living wage so they never need to get these benefits as well. But don't blame the victim. The very people who engaged in the policies that sunk our nation's economic ship are now complaining that we're giving life preservers to the drowning. That's a bit much.
We appreciate your answer. We got another question from Threaded Pixels. What are the most effective way individuals can support programs like SNAP?
One of the most effective ways that people can support programs like SNAP, again, is to contact their elected officials to say support these programs, don't cut these programs, when there is a radio program on. And perhaps people are calling in and saying, oh, it's fraud ridden, it's full of fraud, or boy, I was online behind someone and they were buying a lobster. You hear that croc, you know, all the time, or they're really, really nice shoes. They don't deserve a call and say, wait, now, wait a second. You know, you probably didn't see that. And most of the people need this help are working families, so get real about this. You can write letters to the editor when there are newspaper stories about this. There are blog posts about this you can respond to. There's also a great movie out called A Place at the Table, which I highly recommend. You can download on iTunes. You can go to their websites, Google under A Place at the Table and see this. I'm a little biased because I'm in it, but it's really excellent movie. It's got Tom Colicchio, the wonderful, amazing chef in it. It's got Jeff Bridges, Academy Award winner Jeff Bridges. So I'm thrilled to say I'm in an Academy Award winning winner's movie. It hasn't won an Academy Award yet. We'll cross our fingers. And that's another good way you can educate yourselves about SNAP and the importance of these programs. One self-interested plug, you can support the Capillary Food Bank of Texas and the New York City Coalition Against Hunger by sending us donations. I've also written a book on hunger in America called All You Can Eat, How Hungry Is America. It's available on Amazon. It's available on Kindle. Your better public libraries have a copy of it. I believe the University of Texas Library has a copy of it if you don't have a lot of money, and that'll educate you on the program. But I hate to be a broken record, but first and foremost, contact your elected officials. These are absolutely critical times. And people always say to me, well, without that government stuff, what's the most important thing we can do? And my answer is, that's like saying we're dealing with a drought, and you pose the question, without that water stuff, what's the most important thing you can do, you know, to reduce drought? You can't get rid of drought without water, and you can't preserve the SNAP program without our elected officials taking leadership roles. And contact the White House. You know, remind the president that he's the first president in U.S. history who grew up in a household that briefly received SNAP benefits. He wasn't in the household at the time. His mother was going to nursing school, but she's a perfect example. Someone in a tough time, she's working hard to get by, temporarily needed help from the government. She paid back much, much, much more money over the long run in taxes by her increased earning as a nurse. And certainly, I think you'd argue that her family has made a very, very significant contribution to American society. But the president has to be reminded, too. He's pledged not to cut these programs, but sometimes he hasn't always stood firm against that. So we have to hold all our elected officials accountable.
Well, that's the last of our user our guest questions from off Twitter. Right now, I think we're leaving folks with a sense of this is a pretty big problem. So you know, we don't want to discourage anyone from any. I guess we want to inspire people to act. So
absolutely, and I want to leave with an optimistic note. We dramatically reduced hunger in America in the 1970s. And we almost ended hunger in America because people were engaged. When people were engaged, they made a difference. We used to have slavery in America. People thought it was an insurmountable problem. They thought it was inevitable, but Americans banded together. They took some tough action, including a civil war, but they decided that slavery is barbaric. A civilized country doesn't have slavery, and by citizen action, we ended slavery in America. Child labor is an even more recent example, as recently as 100 years ago. Child labor was legal in many parts of the United States. And again, like in the same way people think hunger's inevitable now, there's nothing we can do about it, we just have to accept it. You know, we decided as a country that no, child labor is unthinkable in a civilized country. It's barbaric in a civilized country, and Americans banded together to get the changes in public policy, so child labor was banned. And so I want to leave everyone on a hopeful note. Do not buy the propaganda that you can't make a difference. Don't buy the party line that individual citizens don't matter. Do not believe that American democracy is dead. Each of you have the power to make a significant difference. It's everyone listening to this reaches out to 100 friends, and they reach out to 100 friends and engages in the movement necessary to end hunger in America. We can end hunger in America in our lifetime. You have the power to make it happen. So I beg you, I plead you, I thank all of you who are already making a difference. I urge you just to dig a little deeper, do a little more, act with your heart and act with your head as well, and together we can end hunger in America and make sure all Americans have access to nutritious, affordable food for themselves and their families.
Well, that's a great place to leave it, Joel. We really appreciate you joining us today. Thank you so much.
Thank you, and thank you guys for all your great work, and thank you everyone for tuning in.
Well, we want to invite everyone who's listening. There's a couple of things that we still have going on for Hunger Action Month. First, we have another Google Hangout. We're going to be chatting with Kevin Concannon. He's the Undersecretary for Nutrition Programs over at the USDA. He'll be joining us on September 27th at 11 a.m. Hopefully, all of our technical issues have been worked out. We won't have the same kind of bumpy road today. But if you want to join us, you can visit our website, awesomebank.org/ham, H-A-M. And so that's going to list all of our events that we're doing this month, raise awareness of hunger in our community. Again, thank you to Joel for your assistance in helping us get some great conversation started. Another way to get some good conversation started is to invite your legislator, your representative, to volunteer with the food bank. We have a, if you go to our Facebook page or to, again, awesomefoodbank.org/ham, you will be able to click on one of our activities, which is to invite your legislator that represents the area to come volunteer for the food bank, and so they can get to know the folks who we are serving and get to understand who the case of hunger is in this community. And so we would love it if folks could do that. So, thank you again, Joel, for coming out today, logging on today.
Thank you.
Okay, thanks everybody, and we'll see you on the 27th.